Good afternoon to all. I am Anoop Naik. I am a research assistant under Professor Phatak. So I will be covering SQL today, mostly SQL and some features which are special to MySQL. So first of all, what is a DBMS? DBMS stands for Database Management Systems, and it is a collection of interrelated data. It's a place where we can store large amount of data, and it also contains a set of programs to access these data easily, efficiently. So database here refers to a collection of data, huge amount of data. For a small amount of data and all, it is used, but it can be effectively used for very large amount of data. So it provides a convenient and efficient way to store and retrieve information. It stores information, not data. It stores some information, that is some piece of data which has some value. So that is known as information. So it provides a convenient and efficient way to store and retrieve information. So why we are using database management systems? So these are the file systems can also files can also be used for storing data, but what are the disadvantages of file systems? Data may be redundant and it's inconsistent. There is difficulty in accessing data, data isolation, integrity problem. There is atomicity problem. Atomicity means I have opened one file, some others have opened the same file, then there will be conflict in I am writing something, he will not be able to read what I write at the same point of time. So that those problems can be solved. Then concurrent access anomalies. Then security issues. There is very less security in files. Let me go into SQL now. What are the basic types? Basic types of data which is stored in SQL. It can be char, varchar. Varchar is a variable length char. Int, small int, numeric, real, double precision, float. So what is the difference between char and varchar? Like I already told you, it's a variable length char. So what is the advantage of char when we are considering varchar? I know there are advantages of varchar over char, but what are the when we are using char over varchar? When we know that the string will be of specific length, then there is no need of using varchar, because varchar takes some time for computation. There is overhead on the database for processing varchar. So when we are sure that the string will be of specific length, then we can use varchar, like in case of phone numbers or pin codes or male, female, F, M. In those cases, there is single character, and we are sure that nothing will be there except these two. So in those cases, we can use char. So now, how to create a table? So this is the syntax of creating a table. Create table. So when we are considering a table, so these are known as attributes. Columns are known as attributes, and these are known as rows are known as tuples. ID and name refers to attributes, and the rows, the data which we store, those are known as tuples. Okay, so this is the general terminology which is used. And now, so create table. A1 is an attribute, D1 is the data type of that attribute, and so on. How many you can give, as many number of attributes that you want, and there are many other integrity constraints like primary key, foreign key, all those things. So here R refers to a relation. In database, tables are known as relations. The terminology used is relations. So this is an example of how to create an instruct, create a table instruct. This is the syntax of how to, I mean, this is the command of how to log into MySQL. So MySQL minus U, whatever is the root, I mean whatever is the username, currently I am logging in as root, and minus P prompts the user to enter a password. So So I have entered into this one, MySQL. So now I want to know how many databases are there. So the command for that is show databases. So it will show whatever database I have in this computer. So actually the concept of database is like there can be many tables. If we want to categorize table into some specific things, like for example all of you might be familiar with Moodle, or okay, nothing. Suppose I have many tables related to students. So I'll be grouping them under students database. Suppose I want to I have some other Joomla. So I will be categorizing those tables under Joomla. So it's just categorizing tables under specific databases. That's all. So I have to specify under which database I have to go first before using or creating or doing anything related to tables and all. So for the command for that is use whatever test. So I have changed the database to the test database. So I can see whatever tables that defined over there, show tables. So these are the two tables in that test database. So now we'll do one thing, how to create a new database. This is the syntax for that. So we'll name it as interns 2012. So I have created one new database, interns 2012, and I'll be using that during this session. So I am in that. Currently there are no tables. So now we'll see how to create a new table. So I have written some queries over here. So I'll be just copying those queries. So this is the query which I explained to you. Create table, instructor, ID is the first attribute and it is of char 5, name which is of varchar 20 and which is not null. This is the constraint which I mentioned to you. The constraint is that it should not be null. So then department number which is of small int, and salary which is of numeric 8, 2. This refers to, like, it can be eight digits in that, out of which two are decimal digits. So I'll be just copying this to I am going to execute this query. So a table has been created. So if I want to know at later point of time, when there are large number of tables, I might not remember all the structure of all the tables. So in order to know the structure of table, the command uses DESC table name. So this will give the structure of that table. So now it has these things. Now we'll insert some values into that table. Okay, I have given this constraint null. So there are now two rows in that table. So how to see that? So these are the two values in that. Now you can see that IDs of both the names are same. So but in most of the cases, like roll numbers, all those things are unique. So in order to specify those, So this is how we have created one table and inserted values into it. Now what is a key? There are many types of keys: super key, candidate key, primary key, foreign key, all those. So if R is a relation table, I mean a table, and A1, A2, A3 are the attributes of that table. So we define a relation schema as R is equal to this one. Okay. And then if K is a subset of R, that is K is some attribute. K can be some column or a collection of column, anything. So K is a subset of R, and if K is a super key of R, if values of K are sufficient to identify a unique tuple of each possible relation. For example, the meaning of this sentence is like, using roll numbers, I can distinguish between each tuple. There will be only one tuple which has that corresponding roll number. So in those cases, that roll number is known as a super key. And so as I have told you, ID can be a super key. If ID is a super key, then ID comma name is also a super key. Even if the name repeats, ID is unique. So ID and name is a super key, and so on. Many we can have as many sets we want. So minimal super key is a candidate key. In this case, ID is a minimal super key. So there can be many other things like phone number. Maybe phone number. If a family contains only one member, then phone number is also a super key and also a candidate key. So, and what is a primary key? The user can select one of the candidate's key as a primary key. Whatever the user can decide upon that, but that should be a unique thing. I mean, it should not repeat. Foreign key. So foreign key, what foreign key is, like I can refer one attribute from another table. I will explain it to you. Suppose consider the same table for ID, name and department number, suppose. And there is another table, department number, department name. Okay. So in this case, I know that department number will be one which appears in this table. So this one can be given as a foreign key to this one. Huh? But there are some constraints of like there can be some problems when using this foreign keys. Like that value, if suppose I am entering some value over here, suppose department number 2, Anoop, ID 1, that department 2 should exist over here. If there is no such department, it will show an error. The database will not allow you to insert a tuple. So that should be there. Always before inserting something over here, make sure that value is over here also. So but one interesting case comes over here. Suppose I have a table structure like this, and I have a column HOD ID. So this HOD will be, suppose this is instructor, this is department table. So there is an interesting case over here. HOD will also be an instructor. So I can give a foreign key like this also. Huh? So then what is the problem over here? We cannot insert even a single tuple in this. If I insert over here, it will check whether first time, if I insert over here, it will check whether it is there in this one. If I am going to insert over it, it will check over here whether it is present or not. So for those cases, there is a special facility, you can say. We can initially defer this constraint. initially we can say to the database, defer it for some time, later on enable that maybe. So while creating a table, you can specify such a constraint. So I will give this example at later point. I will post it on Moodle. Now these are the integrity constraint which can be there in a table: not null, primary key, foreign key, and how to make a attribute primary key. That is by this instruction. So if you want to make a attribute primary key, then you should give like this: primary key, whatever is the attribute over here. Or you can do like this also. You can, before this comma, you can give primary key. So, and then how to make an attribute foreign key. So this is the foreign key consider this as department number. Okay, so this is department number which references to department. So it checks both the names of both these, and it knows that this is a foreign key of this. Primary key declaration on an attribute automatically ensures not null constraint. Okay. So how to drop a table? Drop and delete should be used carefully. Okay. So drop table completely removes the table. It removes the structure of the table also, and the delete table only removes the content of the table. Structure of the table still remains. First of all, what is the problem? Okay, yeah, correct. Sorry. Delete from table is required, or just table name? Yeah. So this deleted the table. So now no rows are selected when we are selecting that. And but DESC will still work. So you can see the structure. So now this will not work. So how to alter a table? You can add columns to a table at later point of time if you want. So alter table are add an attribute A of D data type. Okay. So where A is, yeah, as I explained to you. So how to delete a column from this, from a table? Alter table, drop whatever attribute you want. So how to update a table? Update table name, set salary equal to something, whatever salary, this is just an example, set salary is equal to something, where some constraint id equal to something. So this will set the salary of that person, and then select query, select, as I already used that query, select whatever attribute. Select query is used to display whatever you want, whatever specific part of the table you want to display. Just now I used select star from select star from instructor. So star is like, it will display all the attributes of the table with data. So select, if you want to selectively select some attribute, select a1 a2 an from whatever relations you have, where some constraint. If you want to specify some constraint, you can specify, like where salary is greater than 70,000, or where department is equal to something, maybe anything. And distinct keyword is used to select only the distinct tuples of that table. If I give distinct, it will it will hide all the duplicate entries on from that table. All will display all the tuples of that table. So this is one example. Select name from instructor, where department number equal to something and salary is greater than 80,000. So this is, so here I am displaying only the name from that table. So this is one of the main important part of SQL, Cartesian product. Suppose if you want to combine two tables, like in this case, suppose I have ID, name, department number, but I don't know which department this person belongs to. So we can make a Cartesian product of these two tables. So what Cartesian product does is, it will match. You can see over here. So this is one entry. It will pair this entry with all the other entries from this one. So you can see this is paired with this CS101, CS315, all these entries, and second entry in the same manner, and so on. It will pair all the entries. So if there are 10 tuples in first one and 20 tuples in this second one, so there will be about 200 tuples in the Cartesian product. So but what is the use of this Cartesian product? As I told you over here, this does not make sense. This does not make much sense. But if we want to know which instructor takes which course from this table, so I can do one thing. I can equate this column as well as this column. So if I equate these columns, see, only these entries will match, only these three entries will match, and all other entries will be discarded. So I can know which person is taking which course. So as I told you, for all instructors who have taught a course, find their names and the course ID of courses that they have taught. So this is how we write a Cartesian product, in this sense, Cartesian product with equating whatever we want. So that is known as join. So select name comma course ID from instructor comma teachers. These are two tables, two relations, where instructor dot ID equal to teachers dot ID. So it equates instructor dot ID and teachers dot ID. So but if we want to make a Cartesian product of same table, so there will be problem in this case, isn't it? If I want select name comma course from instructor comma instructor, then how will I write over here, where instructor dot ID equal to instructor dot ID? What, it does not make any sense. So what, yeah, we have to write over here as table, as some alias name, instructor as T comma teachers as S, something like that, where T dot ID equal to S dot ID. So for computer science people, this may seem very simple. So we can rename in the same manner, we can rename all the we can give alias name to some other attributes which we want. Like here I have done a calculation over here, select ID comma name comma salary by 12. So suppose if I want to know the monthly salary by 12 as monthly underscore salary from instructor, so it will make this calculation and name it as monthly salary. So yeah, the specific case which I told you, find the names of all instructors who have a higher salary than some instructor in the department 101. So here we have to make a Cartesian product of the same table. So this is how we do. Select distinct, if you want distinct T comma name, T dot name from instructor as T, this one, and whatever predicate. This is known as the predicate part. Whatever conditions we give, that is known as the predicate part of that. So yeah, now how to match a string. Suppose if I want to display names of all the people who where the name begins by A. So these are the two operators patterns which we use. One is the percentage pattern and the underscore pattern. So percentage pattern, it matches a string, and underscore pattern matches a character. So you will be clear by this example. Select name. Suppose if I want to, as I told you, if I want to display names of all the instructors whose names are starting by A, select name from instructor, where name like is the operator which is used over there. A percentage. So this is the first character, and whatever string which comes after that, it will match that. And if I want to specifically take out all the names where second character is N, then this is the query which I use: name from instructor, where name like underscore, it matches that first character, whatever it may be, it does not care. Second character is the N, and whatever comes after that, so it matches that. So how to order? Suppose I want to order a table according to the salary, descending order of salary or something. So for that I use order by clause. So select name. These are just examples. Okay, don't consider. Select name, whatever you want to display, you can display over there. Select star from instructor, order by name. So it will display those by ascending order. By default it's ascending order. So we can give either DESC for descending order, and we can specify ASC for ascending order. Specifically, if you want, like by default I think it's ascending order. So if I want to display it by descending order, then order by name DESC, it will display all the names in descending order. So I can use this for multiple attributes also. So order by department name comma name. So what it will do is that first it will order by this department name, and for each department name it will order by name. And now between clause, this is one more useful query or construct, we can say. Select name from instructor, where salary between these two. So it will display all the names of those instructors whose salary is between this range. Then there are many aggregate functions. These aggregate functions actually take in as input many tuples and give a single output, single value as the output, more specifically. So sum, average, count, min, max are some of the aggregate functions. I think even there are some more, I don't remember those. So select average of sal from instructor, where department number equal to 101. So what it will do is that for 101, it will take those entries, it will make an average of those entries, average of the salary of those entries, and display only the salary, average salary. So then group by. Suppose if I want to group people according to their departments, then I can use this group by clause. So select department number comma average salary. What this query does is, it will first group by according to the department number first, then it will take an average of the salaries in that group, and for each such group it will display the average salary of those. For 101, for department number 101, it will display maybe 50,000 is the average salary, 102 so and so is it this thing. So first it will group and then take an average. So if somebody wants me to explain it using some examples, just tell me, I'll do that. So another construct is the having clause. Another clause is having clause. So suppose if I want to display or consider salaries only above some specific salaries. So I can use this, select department number comma average of salary whatever from instructor, group by department number having average salary greater than 50,000. So it will first group, then take an average and display only those which have an average greater than 50,000. So you can even use nested subqueries, queries inside queries. So this is one of the examples. Suppose I want to know the courses which are taken in both fall semester as well as the spring semester. So this is one of the examples. You can create any number of examples. So select course ID from teacher stem, consider this as the teacher stem table where semester is equal to fall and year equal to 2009, and course ID of those should be present in this table. It retrieves some tuples, so the course ID should be there in these tuples. So these things should match. Whatever I retrieve from this, course ID should be in this one. So whatever I select from that should match over that. So this can be written in many other ways. This is not the only. We can even use simple queries for this. Just for explaining the nested subqueries, I gave this example. You can write it in many other formats. It's not necessary that you should use subqueries itself. So now, how to install MySQL? So I'm explaining in terms of Linux environment. So if you want to install MySQL, you can open a terminal, then type sudo apt-get install MySQL server, MySQL client, these things. Even MySQL client will work, I think. And if you want to use Synaptic Manager, that is if you can even install it using Synaptic Manager. There is a utility Synaptic Manager. So go to Synaptic Manager, just search for this package and apply that. Just mark that package for installation and then apply those changes. Then there is a utility PHP MyAdmin. How many of you know? Right now I am using terminal for all these things. So it's like the user interface is not too good. If you want to do things fast, then there should be some utility by which you can see tables in a graphical format or something like that. So there are many utilities, I think. So PHP MyAdmin is written in PHP for accessing MySQL. So I can just log into this. I can see this graphically. See, these are the tables which you had already seen, these are the databases. Now I have created this interns, this thing. We had dropped that table, so currently there is no table. So I can show you other table, students table. So this has one table, and if you want to see the data in that, just browse that table and it will show in one specific form. If you want to know the structure of that table, you can do that. These are the structures. Even you can write some SQL queries for this, many other things. Just explore these features. And now one main important thing, how to create users in MySQL. I have logged in as root right now. So we can restrict each user to some specific databases. So for those who don't know, so how to know who all are the user present in that? So this is the query which is used. MySQL is a database, user is a table. So I'll display once again. So these are the databases which are already present, out of which MySQL is the table which is used, I mean database which is used by MySQL. So it contains information about MySQL which is installed here. So how to know the different users who are there in, so these are the users and password is encrypted. So suppose if I want to create a new user, so create user Anup or any specific name. So this is first one is the username and this is the password. Okay, so create user Anup identified by Anup as the password. So this will create a user. It has created a user. Now we'll log into so I have logged in as Anup right now. And now suppose I want to use some databases. Just now we created interns 2012. So it is showing an error. Access denied. I am not allowed to access those databases. So how will you do that? So for that, there are commands. You can grant permissions to user. This is how you give. Grant all. All means insert, update, whatever. Grant all on demo is the database name dot star, whatever tables are there in the database to this user. Yeah. So after making this, for this you have to you should have some permission to give others that permission. Otherwise, it, for example, I should be root user for giving such a permission, or some other user who has got this permission to give permission to others. So otherwise, we cannot this command will show an error that you have not got permission to grant permissions. So this is how after, suppose if I log in as root right now and give execute this command, then it will give permission to whatever database which I have specified over here. Then how to drop a user? I can drop a user, drop user, username. So that's all. So this is the reference which I used. Do you know where last time intern had asked me a question? Where is the data of this MySQL stored? Actually stored. We know that it's stable. But actually, it should be somewhere inside the table. I mean, somewhere inside the computer. Actually, there is a file mysql.cnf. In that file, it specified where the data is stored. So I'll show you that. So it is in etc. So MySQL. So mysql.conf. Yeah, see this. But we will not be able to access it directly. I will show you that also. What was the path? Slash var slash lib slash MySQL. Slash var slash lib. Yeah, MySQL. Even then we can do that. We'll see. Yeah, we'll see. Oh, okay. One second. So see, whatever databases which we created, those are in something like a directory format. Yeah, that's all.